Hello everybody, and welcome back to Flight Simulator X. We're here in Nassau, the Bahamas, and we've got a flight to, I'll tell you where it is in a minute, once I kind of work it out. I got it written down, but I never wrote down the airport and I can't remember. Let's look around here and, actually let's just do it this way, it's quicker. Handbrake is on, that is good. We'll get a start going on here as well. We'll open up the fuel tanks. Get that going on. That's fine. Give ourselves a little bit of fuel pumping. Is on. And we will get on here. Wait for our NG to come up. We had fuel pumped in anyway, so kind of auto-started on us. Jesus. What's going on? Brakes, 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 brakes. I set those brakes, didn't I? Bloody hell. Well, that's good, isn't it? Runaway plane. That would get you in quite a bit of trouble, I'm thinking. Anyway, our start is done. We haven't changed our fuel since the last flight, but I think we're going to be okay. We are flying direct to MYA. No, it's not that. Hang on. It's MYA. Shoot, that's the wrong way to do it. I thought that would just work. A. T. Which is Treasure K. Alright, so we will, we'll enter that. And if we go, we'll activate it as well, be damned. If we go to the flight plan, then we can add in a couple of little details that we are looking for. Now, I haven't changed my setup, so we need to still be careful. It'll be H I can do. The A and the S I can't with the keyboard, because it throws me out of visual. But that is N, K, and X. Or not. Seem to be having a little bit of difficulty here. A. Oh yeah, you know, I didn't progress, so that's why it'll fall out. This is a bit annoying. Okay, let's progress. And then it's NKX in the Bahamas. So we'll enter that. And then, after that, which is 64 nautical miles, 102 direct. Okay. Should have put that in before, shouldn't we? Jeez. So, we will clear that. Yes. Go up one. And then we will put this in. And we will enter. Enter. Yes. Enter. There we go. Not too shabby. Alright, we have one more to put in. After all this drama, we'll get it in here. And we'll run that up. And that is 4-U-D-P-E. Not P-U-D-P-E, you gobshit. God, why didn't you stop me from doing that? 4-U-T-P-E. And that is in the Bahamas, and we will enter that as well. And now we have a flight plan that is kind of going all over the place, which is not right. I think we found a problem here. It should be the other way around. Christ. So that goes down and we will enter that. Then we will go down one. And then we will enter the link in there. And then we will enter that. I just need to go into the activity. And then we will enter that, and that's better. So it's Hank's Rudy map, which is correct. That is showing up at 105, which is correct. It should take me around about 3/4 of an hour. And I did have an altitude of 3,000 feet, and I'm considering making that significantly higher. But that is where we're at right now, and that we are going to activate. Alright, so that much is out of the way. We will open up here to fuel. Everything else is looking good there. We will drop one set of flaps. Everything is looking here. Okie dokie. The system is there. Reset fuel is back. Okay. Good. Let's stick this back on here. We won't be needing it. Let's get out of jail. We're not going to bother using traffic today. We're just going to tick along here and try and find our way across the grass. Get over to the airport. I guess we'd do is we should listen to the ATIS.
Nassau Airport Information, Charlie. 1700 Zulu. Wind 112 at 12. Visibility greater than 20 miles. Sky condition, ceiling 1700 broken. Temperature 152.13. Altimeter 2974 ILS. Runway 14 in use.
Depart straight out. 14 is in use, so we'll go back over here.
Cessna November 992 Bravo Tango. Taxi to and hold short of runway 14. Easy taxiway Lima 5 Hotel. Contact tower on 119.5. One ready.
119.5, thank you. We'll just run ourselves down here. Lima 5 Hotel. Well, this is not Lima 5. This is... not sure what it is. 5. Okay. That worked out quite well. Hotel will be this taxiway down here. Just keep going. We're clear. And hotel is this taxiway here. Alrighty. So, pretty okie dokie. That's okay. And we will try and go straight here for a second. We're going to run down to the end of the runway and then we're going to hold short, which is fine. You can hear my phone going off in the background there. When we're doing this, we will set our altitudes. Maybe using the right knob. I'm thinking about getting up towards. Might be a little bit more sensible. Flight director on. Which is okay. This for a climb of 4 feet a minute. And we will work our way down here ever so steadily. So this is another one of these flights that we're going to be doing in order to try and confirm that the information we have is good. I'm already changing our cruise altitude from 3,000, which was put in, and I think I put that in, to 7,000, which I think is probably a little bit better. We are flying over water. But we're not going to be too far away from land at any particular point in time. Nevertheless, I think a little bit of altitude that we can convert into, distance, should we run into a problem, is always a very good idea. We are in a single-engine aircraft, after all. And obviously this is all virtual and nobody gets hurt, but in respect to the truth of it, I just kind of think it's kind of cool if we try and show a little bit of respect and try and do things right. So it's around a fort somewhere, slowly. Gone to west. Clicked on it and that was the problem. Anyone? Let's get back onto the center line there. And it's about there. Heading is 142, we're not far off. And I think we can probably get in contact with tower. Yeah, we don't have it yet. We need to get to our position and bring it up to a stop. We will be doing some flights in the TBM 850 as well. I'm quite looking forward to those. Excuse me. But for the time being, because we are validating and verifying the list of flights we have, we just need to get on and start doing them. And the Cessna 208 has quite a schedule, which we'll be working on together. And I'm just going to fly this to get basic information, namely that the route makes sense, which it kind of does. It looks like it makes sense. You can see that we're kind of flying in the general direction, and we are using a little waypoint over the ocean between the islands to just, you know, show a bit of respect to routing and all the rest. Pilots in KV Air will end up kind of using whatever they consider to be their best route. This routing is at best only guidance. The other aspect of it is that as the AirX change, some of the routing details may change along with it. And we had a bit of a conversation last night over exactly what to do in that situation. And I think the reality is we're going to have to just deal with that as and when it up. So we'll take a clearance from the tower now, hopefully.
Cessna November 9-9-2, Bravo Tango clear for takeoff, runway 14, departing straight out, approved.
Roger that, thank you. 14 for ourselves, and straight out is approved, okay. We'll turn on those. Flap setting for takeoff, that's good, power is good. We will open up our mixture a little bit. Set our flap up to full Yankee. Lights, camera, action. Our runway, and let's feed in the power. Nice and steady build up. Feels like it's good. We got airspeed coming alive. Pushing through the full power. There it is. And a little bit of wind blowing us around. Hang on to it, Jack. That's us up. Power a little bit. Still haven't sorted out this throttle. Anyway, straight out, so we're flying the runway. And we will bring up our flaps. No, let's bring them down. I need to change that as well. Just trim our aircraft out a little bit. And that's not too shabby. And I'm assuming we need to kind of turn to the north. Frequency change approved. Thank you very much. Bye now. So we will turn on the autopilot and the auto damper and see what that does. Keep us climbing, I think it does. And we will just flick through these just to make sure it gets picked up. And the roadside temperature 16 degrees, so we're not too bad on that. Looks like we've got a bit of going around to do here. Let me think, 14 off that, we took off in that direction. Yeah, we have a bit of going around to do. I'm not sure exactly why. Well, I guess that would make sense, actually. Not too sure. Anyway, we are up and away. Scratch the leg. And we can kind of secure our lights. Aircraft power is pretty good. We're, funnily enough, on 1900 on the prop RPM, which is that. It's 95%. 1993 on the torque, which is, I think that's okay. We're not going to use ice, and we'll just carry on. I did a little bit of scenery reordering, which I'm kind of hoping has made a positive effect to the scenery down below, and I kind of half believe it has. It's always a little bit of a misnomer for me in kind of what scenery order to put stuff in. I was flying in Innsbruck earlier, and I'd also changed some of the resolutions for the scenery, and I have to say FTX was looking really quite impressive. And here we are flying out of Nassau, and I'm more than impressed with it as well. Some ships that are in port there, we're going to fly over those. We're kind of going to carry around through 30 degrees, heading towards basically a direct north orientation. So all is good. My drink of this evening is water, class A, good old H2O, and it's not your ordinary water out of a tap, and it's not bottled water, which is ordinary water in a bottle, as far as I'm concerned, half the time. This is spring water, natural spring water, drugged up out of the spring by my good self, and I don't know, I got some of it, so I decided to drink it. No point in wasting it. So here we are heading out, just looking back at the airport runway orientation. I can see the airport down there, and I'm a little bit concerned at our routing at the moment. That's because we haven't turned on nav. Let's dip over. It's always something, isn't it? Here we go. Because we'd gone through north, and we were continuing around in a circle. Because I hadn't set up the aircraft correctly. Again! There you go. One other thing that I've started to try out, and it doesn't seem to have caused any issues so far, is to update the VORs and the waypoints and intersections and things within the default database, so that maybe we're using a little bit more up-to-date stuff than the default FSX database, which is 10 years of age now and way out of date. The bad news about Coronado, and this is something that you need to be aware of if you're buying this aircraft, there's no way to update the nav data in terms of, outside of updating the default information, let's say. They take a hard copy of whatever the default information is, and that's what you're working with, so there's no way to update the default information, and it doesn't seem that it's pulling the default information from the sim, and it seems that it's, to my understanding, it's hard-coded in. Ah, where are the hiccups coming from? The fact that it's hard-coded in is bad, really. I do not understand why Coronado have chosen to do this. I'm a little bit disappointed by the fact that that is their strategy. It seems at odds with their attempts to create lovely, good models here. I don't know what their reasoning for it is. Their folks like myself are willing to go to the expense, in some cases, of getting updated information once in a while, or even regularly. And the only kind of updates that we can do are what is apparently available from some resources in the Flight Sim community. But it doesn't update all the information. I haven't really been able to work out exactly what it does and what it hasn't updated. I don't know how much of the default FSX nav data is pulled in each time and how much of it is hard-coded. I was led to believe it was all hard-coded, and I really don't know if that's the case. But in any case, unlike a PMDG, which is the other extreme, or unlike Aerosoft or many of the other larger aircraft makers, virtual, you know, FSX models, which have the ability to use Navidata or Navigraph for, you know, some add-on after the event. It doesn't appear that Carinato do that. And consequently, there are quite a few bits and pieces that are not available on the G1000 screen here, which is another bugbear of mine. Like to see quite a bit more done with that, and because the G1000 is in the model, it's not even possible to easily bring in a third party, you know, pay add-on like Mindstar Aviation. I don't know if there's some "I don't like you" childishness going on between the management of both groups, or what the logic behind the strategy of that decision is. But it's a little bit kind of annoying, and I'm a bit concerned about the future use of this. As far as Coronado is concerned, I suppose they're laughing to the bank because they've got my money, and I'm not going to get a refund for it. I'm not asking for a refund either. I have bought a couple of their aircraft, including the TBM 850, and I believe I have a Skyhawk 182. No, I have a Mooney Bravo from them. Maybe I even have the Skyhawk as well, actually. Or the Sky... Not sure which one I have. Skyhawk is 172, isn't it? Or the Skyhawk, the 152 and the... Anyway, I've got the 182 Turbo. And I think I got it from Flight 1, which is Coronado. Anyway. Ah, I can't remember. I haven't flown it for a while. But they're all G1000 models, and they're all the same G1000. And I'm loving the aircraft in terms of everything else. The fidelity is really quite satisfactory for my needs, with the exception of this G1000. And I really would like for them to provide an option, you know, provide a model file that is empty of the knobs and the screens here, so that I could essentially put in a Cap 140 autopilot up here instead of this autopilot, and put in the Mindstar Aviation G1000 MDF and PDF. Then I can use my Navigraph information, and I can carry on grand, and then leverage everything else from Coronado, which would be tickety-boo. And they can do it, you know, it's a Mindstar Aviation deal. I'm not going to be, and Coronado can say, look, it's not our fault. You do this at your own merit. You do this with your own, you know, your own risk. It's not anything that we're going to take care of. I appreciate that. I can do that. Anyway, where are we on this machine? route. We are here. We're making some progress towards Hangex. We have 13 nautical miles to go. That's about 15 standard miles. Yes. And then to Route P before we'll set up for a 16-mile approach into Pearl K or Paris K or whatever the hell we're going. This is another one of these kind of new routes for KVA, which I'm testing out and flying. We're just about to reach our cruise altitude of 7,000, which is I think quite nice up here. Actually, I like it anyway. Airspeed is running along the 160 mark. We'll probably breach 164 or 165 by the time we steady state here. We do, I believe, have the wind behind us. I had that on a minute ago, didn't I? That's the DMEs, I don't want that option too. Yeah, we got a 35 knot wind, giving us a little bit of a boost along here, which means that our indicated 162 will translate to a ground speed of significantly more, 209, which is pretty good. So the weather on this day is going to be fairly decent. One thing I didn't do, foolishly, is actually start the clock. Why didn't I do that? We'll have to just check the video, I suppose. Ugh, that was a mistake. Kinda needed that as well. What's our estimated on the flight plan? ETA is 1342 or 1321, so that's at least 20 minutes. And 20 minutes, we've done a third of the way, so probably looking in the region of... It's only 105 nautical miles. It's 20 minutes. And with this wind, that's odd, isn't it? Total this is 105 nautical miles. We're running at kind of 200 knots, so it should be about a 30 minute flight. I guess that is what it is. There's 20 minutes left before we get to Pearl K or Precious K or whatever it's called. And so we're about 10 minutes in the air already, give or take, I suppose. Yeah, okay, that's probably about right. And somebody else flying this is going to have different weather conditions, so they might climb to a different altitude. This is guidance rather than absolute, exact, no doubt about it kind of deal. Change now as we get from Hank towards Rugby. And we're moving along grand. Everything in here is looking green. Not pushing anything too hard. And generally we're not doing too shabby. We've used 112 pounds and we'll probably use another 112, so I'm reckoning 250 or something in that region will be what we'll end up with. Air temperature is -3, but we're not in the cloud at the moment, so we're okay. I'll have to keep an eye on that, though. This week's, or this day's big kind of topic in my mind has been navigation data, and that was kicked off because there's one of the small little strips in the Florida Keys, which the code for it is a little bit different between FSX and X-Plane. It's referred to a long name as the Sugarloaf strip runway, and it's FD51, I think. FD71 or FS71 or F571. Sugar, I don't know. It's down in the Floridian Keys now. It's between Marathon and Key West, on the chain. So you'll be able to find it. That in FSX and on Sky Vector and on some of the other locators that I've kind of looked it up was common, but in X-Plane it has a different ID. And the F571 or FD571 or whatever it isn't found on X-Plane. So what we've decided to do for the purpose of just moving on, because it is a nice little short runway that's a little bit technical. You'll have to kind of control your speed and your glide in, and kind of hit your marks to get down and down safely. We've decided to leave it in, and we've just put in a little note saying, you know, if you're flying X-Plane, look out for this code to identify the airport if it's a short flight, you know, out of Miami. You'll still need a kind of a direct to on the GPS to do. The result of that conversation, however, had me kind of thinking, well, now, hang on a minute. What is my status of navigation data in my sim? Because I haven't actually updated it. I don't purchase Navigraph yet, and I may very well begin to do that, but right now, presently, I don't. So I'm running off default FSX Navigraph or nav data. And that is all of, well, when was FSX released? How many years ago was that? That's how old my data is. And the world has changed. Magnetic variance has changed. IACO or whatever they're called, codes have changed here and there. So I found a site, aerosor.fr, or aero-sor.fr. It's a guy who has offered quite a cool service, from what I can make out, with update files that you can download, and it'll save the originals and replace the originals with the updated information. And that updated information is corresponding with current Navigraph information, presently 2016. It's kind of a donationware type of deal, so it's free, essentially. Although I think folks are welcome to throw a donation his way. I'm going to give it a run and see what I get. See if it all makes sense. I'm still trying to kind of work out how I'm going to compare the old and the new. I haven't really prepared anything before to compare against now that I've updated, so it's not necessarily a great approach. But I'm definitely going to look and see if there's any anomalies or any gotchas or any failures, and if there aren't, and I don't expect there will be, then I'm more than likely going to, you know, throw in the price of a pizza and a beer. By way of saying thank you very much. Island out there has got a little bit more going on it now, and I'm wondering if that's a result of my scenery reorganization. I'm hoping it will. We'll have a look at that on the way back. But the end result of that is to be determined, but immediately it's looking quite good. So aero-sor.fr. The site is in English. FR suggests it's a French domain, but that doesn't necessarily mean anything. This guy has put a lot of effort into making this happen, so if it's good, and it seems to be, it's something that is probably to be recommended and shared in the community. As usual, I am probably, you know, coming to it late, but anyway, isn't that the case? Let's get some early information from, or not. Should be close enough to be able to pick up MY-80 now. And we're not. Okay, well, we'll wait. Boom, baby, doom, baby, doom, baby, doom. ticking along here quite nicely overall, though, now. I have upped my water by one notch, which I'm liking the effect. It's given that whole Caribbean blue water type of effect. Quite a nice presentation. And doesn't seem to be affecting my frame rates. I've also upped by a notch, basically, everything else. You know, the land density, the autogen. I've decided that I'm going to use a few frames from my super frame rate, which is actually not a sarcastic statement anymore. My frame rate, for some reason, is excellent as a result of turning Aero on my Windows 7. And I believe it is. I haven't gone back to basic. Or did I? I think I did go back to basic and it did drop. I didn't do an extensive test on it, though. But I've also turned up the aircraft resolutions and things here. I do find that the G1000 screens are still a little bit far away, kind of, in terms of how they present. They're not so clear once you have to get up close and personal with them to really see them nicely. But generally, it's all good, really. Anyway, there we are, tracking up the bay of wherever the hell we're going. I really should pay more attention. But this is a nice little flight that is keeping us... It's going to keep us busy. It's going to add another little short run for folks to, you know, get some experience and get some time going on. We're still probably looking at an overall half an hour type of flight time. What did I write down for the... I wrote down 42 minutes of a flight time, actually, based on Sky Vector and running at 168 or 178, maybe it was 178 knots, and we're doing 115 now, so we're really getting a little bit of a boost on here. So that 45 minutes or 42 minutes, was it 42? 42, yeah, 40. That 42 minutes is going to drop down into the 30s for sure, because of that tailwind that is pushing us along here quite nicely. It also means, given the direction of the wind, I'm probably going to hope that the runway... Yeah, just looking here on the screen, we can see that the runway is a northwest-southeast runway, so I'm going to head out toward the northwest and land in the southeasterly direction. And we'll do this as a totally visual landing this time. That might bring the time back up closer to the 42 minutes, which is okay. Once we get to Rupi, we have a 16 nautical mile range to come in, and that'll be enough for me to do a fly over the field and then make a left base turn and final. So that'll do quite nicely. Let's see if we can actually do the field right now. Yes, we can. Treasure Cay, not Precious or whatever I was calling it. Treasure Cay. So we can tune in to the traffic. We can select a runway for landing. And I'm going to select 14 again because that is the runway that it's going to keep us honest. And we'll tell them our intentions a little bit later. This is obviously a non-controlled airport. So Treasure Cay, Cessna 182 for a full stop landing, runway 14. Treasure Cay would be the announcement that I would make. I wouldn't bother with tail numbers. I would just give aircraft type and go from there. I think I'm going to alter our altitude down to now. We'll throw in a gentle 400 dip here as we approach and get down to 3,000 without overspeeding. And in order to do that, I'm going to back up on the torque quite a bit, actually. Get it back to about there. 1500, maybe 16. Okay, well, okay, maybe 17. 1600. That seems to suggest that we're able to kind of maintain a steady speed, but we are actually dropping down 400 feet per minute, which will be nice. We're still on nav, so we will kind of turn in over the field, and 3000 is going to be okay. We don't have any other traffic in the area. We'll keep a visual out as well. We do need to drop below these clouds. I am actually liking what the scenery is, the scenery changes have done. It seems to have improved quite nicely. The other thing I noticed since I did a little bit of config changing here, and the FPS has come up nicely. I've never had such good FPSs. I don't know what I've done, but I've done something. Is that the fan up front, you can just about see the propeller going around, and it's almost believable again, as opposed to not seeing anything or having some very odd looking kind of thing going on. This is kind of back to believable again, which is kind of part of the whole deal, isn't it? Once you get past flying, you want to fly a little bit more, you want to fly a little bit more sensibly, then you want to try and mimic real world as much as you can, in the knowledge that it's a simulator, and the compromises are limiting that, but bad habits, they need to be identified and corrected. But fun is kind of the main purpose of this as well. And if that's not part of the recipe, then either you're doing it for a completely different purpose of, you know, training or preparation for something in the real world, or you have a different attitude than I do, I suppose. Kind of working to a principle of anything like if I was in the real world and I found myself in the aircraft and the pilot jumped out and said see you later and pulled the chute and sailed away drifted away laughing on the wind, would I be able to take over the aircraft and land it? That I think every sim pilot probably has contemplated that question at least once. Looks like there's something going on down there. Now we are in, what's our temperature? +1, we're probably okay in terms of icing conditions, but we do have some waves or something showing up down there, crashing off, so that's interesting. Well, what's causing that? Is that real? It looks like it is. They're kind of occurring at a bit of a high frequency there, but that's nice. The aircraft is now, after making its final turn, the runway is kind of directly ahead of us. We do have the wind coming in off of our left rear quarter, so we are kind of cutting back into that a little bit. And we might need to increase our rate of descent here, which 1100 feet a minute, that's very, very capable in this aircraft. See what we can stabilize at. I'm afraid we're going to overrun that, so excuse me. That was a sneeze that just caught up on me. Hiccups earlier, I got a sneeze now. What's going on? Who knows? Anyway, the airport is kind of in front of our nose, just off the right. We're coming down, aiming for 3,000. We'll level out and head past the airport that way, and then we'll come back a little bit further to track here. We've got another 10 nautical miles to track, so I'll track that, and then we'll turn around. If we can get a little bit lower, we might be able to pick out the airport. It's actually kind of underneath the right side of the nose there now. That's okay. Airspeed is still fine. We haven't broken any kind of rules that way. Running a fairly decent mixture here. What's our fuel burn? 212, so radio. I don't quite see it yet. The co-pilot, if we had one, would probably be able to call it to me. Oh, wait a minute. It's right in front of us. What am I talking about? There it is. Wait a minute. What am I... Ah, okay. Yeah. Never mind what I said. The runway is out in front of the nose. So this approach is fairly good. We'll do a kind of a midfield flyover and then take a turn, come around, and we'll land from the north side of the field, northwest. Only 6 nautical miles away, and we're dropping down to 3,000 feet. Yeah, we're okay for now. Have the aircraft nicely trimmed out here, so when I come off autopilot, I'll be able to just take over the stick and everything will be fine. So at this point in time, I suppose I would announce that we are a full stop landing. See, Treasure K, Cessna, we are, and I can tell them exactly, we are 4 nautical miles south of the field. We're going to fly over midfield for a left downwind to make a full stop landing on runway 14. K or something like that would be what a professional pilot would say, only they would say it a lot more succinctly and professionally and generally much better than I do. The field does look like it is plenty long for us. We don't have any issues here. At this point in time, I am going off. Thank you. We are now hand flying the aircraft. I'm just going to put in a little bit more. Go down, and we're now just going to let it drift down. A couple of ooh, we're getting a little faster. Just need to keep our descent going on here. We've got some low cloud, so I'm going to aim up the coast here, and that single road that's going up to the north of the island. Probably head up that side of the coast towards where that road comes out to the coast, or at least we'll head up a good bit of the coast in that direction, and then what we'll do is we will make a left turn. There's the runway there that we've kind of passed over, so we'll be landing into the wind, and that'll help. We just have to make sure the speed slows down, which I think the against this will help also. So let's kind of level out a little bit, or at least reduce our descent rate a little bit. And we've made our announcements. We'd probably make or two when we've turned base here, and then when we come in on final, give them a 2 mile final or something like that, would be kind of what we would give. Slow enough now that we can drop in a set of flaps, and I think we're far enough away that we can begin our lazy turn. So Cessna 208 or Treasure K, Cessna 208 turning base, runway 14 for a 2 mile final. Calling that 2 miles, I have no idea. Sounds like what a professional pilot would say, right? Slowing down quite a bit here now, so we're going to kick in a little bit of power, drop the nose a little bit. Need to do that to reduce some height anyway. The flaps have given us quite a bit of drag, and we do have that wind to contend with, so let's not fall out of the sky forgetting our speed. We don't want to overspeed now either. 150 is still okay for that first flap setting, and this is not necessarily a great base turn, but we'll follow the road and then just drop in. Glide slopes, yeah, forget about glide slopes, we'll talk about that sometime when I know what I'm doing. Now we are dropping our altitude, which is keeping our speed up quite a bit, so I'm just going to level the aircraft a little bit and let that speed bleed down to maybe the 125 mark, if we can, just dropping our descent rate a little bit. We're still quite high actually. But that's what I'm looking for, so I can put in full flaps here and then then we will trim the aircraft again and continue with our descent. Wind is going to blow us a little bit to the north of the runway now, so we will carry on our descent. I tend to have very high descents. This is indicative of inexperience and somebody who doesn't know what they're doing. 91 on the speed. We should have turned these lights on, so we'll turn them on now. And let's forget about lights and stupidness, and let's just put this aircraft down sensibly. So I've killed the power now quite a bit, maybe a little bit too much, but I have another 400 feet to drop. And looking at the Pappies, I am high, which is always... I suppose this is better than being too low. You can do something about it. But we'll carry on. 85. We're flying. This is okay. We're not going to be landing on the numbers. We can take the power out. That looks like we're going to be kind of all right. We're going to be long. Kind of crush that landing a little bit. Get a little bit of slowdown going on. Get our brakes going on. And just have a quick look at the time. It's 13:45. So that's not too shabby. And I guess we're just going to work our way down the runway here. I don't know what's down there. Maybe there's a building down there at the end. We will mosey on down. This is a single strip runway. There's no taxis on there, so you're going to have to backtrack the runway to get off. What I suppose we might do is we might bias ourselves over to one side of the runway as a mitigation against anybody else coming down. Often do that with IL-2 Cliffs of Dover. If there's multiples landing, we'll pick a side of the runway, and once we've landed and we're taxiing out, we'll get over to the side, and if somebody else is coming in to land, they have a little bit of room to get around. Oh, there is a kind of an FBO area here, and some parking and all the rest, so that's bueno. But that was a nice little flight overall, and it's one that I'm sure some of the lads in KVA will enjoy making. It's to an airport that perhaps is not often frequented, and I'm not sure how to get onto this. We might have to go across the grass. Let's just open that up. It's been a clear day flying, but I don't want to pick up any rubbish on the grass here. But having a Cessna going across flat grass is, you know, it's not the end of the world. It's just that there is no linkage here between this part and what's been put over there. It looks like there was a taxiway that's been overrun there, so that's alright. Let's just swing that around here and bring it to a stop. Good enough, I'm saying. So we'll stick the handbrake on, and hopefully that'll stay on this time. We don't want to scare ourselves like we did before. We'll bring the power back, drop that off, and let them run down. Fuel cutout. Keep doing that the wrong way always. Okay, shoot, we didn't bring the lights out, and I don't know if we brought the flaps up. I need to start using checklists. But that's going to be this video. Another flight done, and generally speaking, I think we're going to fly a little higher. Otherwise, the 42-minute guidance is fairly okay, and the flight plan is good as well. That's it for now. Until the next time, as they say, go handy.